My dearly beloved in Christ, it is very fitting that one of the six holy days of obligation that we observe in this country would be the Feast of All Saints on November 1st. It is very fitting because, first of all, it is our duty to honor the saints of God. And by honoring them, we are honoring God who made them saints. Now, when I say God made them saints, we have to understand, not without their cooperation. Because there are two things that bring about sanctity, that bring about holiness, that lead souls to heaven. One is the grace of God. The other is the cooperation of the individual. And both are indispensable. God does not make someone a saint automatically. That person must cooperate. That person must continue to cooperate and endure various trials and so forth. But indeed, we can say, as the old saying goes, God is wonderful in his saints. We see the different kinds of saints. You can see Saint Francis of Assisi embracing poverty, Saint Mary Magdalene and so many other penitents living lives of penance and atonement. You see the saint of joy, Saint Philip Neri, who was remarkable for his joy and love of God and exuberance. You see, again, so many other saints known for their charity, Saint Vincent de Paul and others like him, and so forth. Saint Francis de Sales, known for his meekness and gentleness. And truly, God is wonderful in his saints. They bring out in their lives these attributes of Almighty God, these qualities that they have learned and cultivated by meditating on the Gospels. And so we honor the saints and we desire to become one of them, to become a saint ourselves. And that doesn't mean that we will necessarily equal them, but we should aspire to the holiness to which God calls us. And I would like to reflect upon a verse from the epistle and then also today's gospel. And towards the end of the epistle that we read, St. John says that he saw this vision. All the saints were standing about the throne and the elders and the four living creatures, and they fell on their faces before the throne and worshiped God. And he also says that I saw a great multitude which no man could number out of all nations and tribes and peoples and tongues. Imagine that, a multitude, not just thousands and hundreds of thousands, but millions of saints in heaven from every age, from every nation, every race, every tongue, as he says. All of these saints who cooperated with the grace of God and earned their salvation, what a glorious sight it will be that we will one day behold. And indeed, even here below, it is good to try to paint a picture in your mind of this magnificent vision that St. John was privileged to see of the saints of God. And he says, with palms in their hands, the palm was a symbol of victory, of overcoming trial and suffering. We typically picture the martyrs holding palms in their hands. But all the saints were martyrs in a sense. If not bloody martyrs, dry martyrs, enduring suffering and trial for the love of God. So that's a reflection from today's epistle on the beautiful panorama of the saints of God. But the gospel is taken from the very first section of what is called the Sermon on the Mount. Now, the Sermon on the Mount is given to us by St. Matthew over three chapters, chapters 5, 6, and 7 of his gospel, and it is well worth reading. It is a summation of all of our Lord's teaching, of striving for holiness, renouncing the world, practicing charity and mercy and forgiveness, and so on and so forth. A beautiful summary. But our Lord begins by listing what we call the 8 Beatitudes. Now, the 8 Beatitudes are 8 practices of virtuous living that rise above the commandments. Do you remember the story of the young man who went up to our Lord and he said, "What must I do to gain the kingdom of heaven. And our Lord said, you know the commandments, honor your father and mother, thou shalt not kill. And our Lord enumerated some of the Ten Commandments. And the young man says, I've done all of that since my youth. What more can I do? And our Lord talked to him about renouncing the world, giving up everything in the world. But that statement of our Lord indicates that everyone must keep the commandments of God, of course, to get to heaven. But there is more that can be done to gain a higher place in heaven, to give more honor and glory to God, and to sanctify ourselves. And in particular, there are the eight Beatitudes. So what are they? They are virtuous practices that are above and beyond just observing the commandments. So let's review them briefly. First of all, blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Our Lord often spoke of the danger of materialism and of attachment to the things of this world. But we all must possess things of this world to use for our needs, our home, an automobile, food, clothing, etc., etc. But we must be detached from these things. And that is poverty of spirit. Blessed are the poor in spirit. That is something we must strive for. Second, blessed are the meek. And notice the reward our Lord gives for the meek. Blessed are the meek, for they shall possess the land. And what does that mean? Someone who is meek holds an attraction over us. We are impelled, we might say, to love this person, to esteem this person, to want to have that person for our friend. Meekness or gentleness was a particular quality of our Lord that drew the people to him. And he himself said, learn of me, for I am meek and humble of heart. So those who are meek possess the land in that everyone is drawn to them. They have no enemies. Everyone loves them and esteems them and wants to be their friend. So the meek, in that sense, have a reward even in this life. But meekness is particularly a way that we imitate our Lord, who was known for his meekness. So blessed are the meek, for they shall possess the land. Number three, blessed are they that mourn, for they shall be comforted. Now that is a strange one, isn't it? Blessed are they who mourn. But what did Our Lady say to little Bernadette at Lourdes? I do not promise you happiness in this life, but in the next. And if you look at the lives of the saints, you see them weeping over sin, their own sins, the sins of the world. And there is a danger of too much frivolity, too much enjoyment of the things of this world. And that is what our Lord means here, our blessed are they who mourn, to mourn over the state we are in, a fallen human nature, so much affected by our passions, so much drawn away from God by the things of this world. We are in a state of warfare. St. Paul says that, I fight. Every day we fight against the world, the flesh, and the devil. So that's what our Lord means by blessed are they who mourn. They understand the dangers, especially the chief danger, the ultimate danger of losing one's immortal soul. And so blessed are they who mourn over these things, for they shall be comforted. Number four, blessed are they who hunger and thirst for justice. Now, isn't that a beautiful way to describe a desire for justice, that justice be done, especially the ultimate justice, which is giving God what is his due, because justice is giving to everyone what is their due. And ultimately, we owe to God obedience, worship, submission to his holy will. And those who hungered and thirsted for justice were the saints. And we see that when they sought to be so conscientious, to do the will of God in even the smallest thing. That's hunger and thirst for justice. And they will be satisfied. They will be filled. They will especially have their reward in heaven for their conscientiousness in this world. Number five, blessed are the merciful, for they shall obtain mercy. Mercy is especially a quality that emulates God himself and his attributes. We know God is just, but he is also infinitely merciful. And we all are examples of that. The mercy of God to us. How many times we have been forgiven when we don't deserve it. So that's mercy. Mercy is forgiveness. Not just always demanding strict justice from others, but forgiving. Forgiving a debt. Practicing the mercy that we see in our Lord, who was accused by his enemies of eating with, consorting with sinners, sitting down at table with them, of loving sinners. And indeed he did. He said, I came to seek that which is lost. Is it not the sick who need the physician? So we also should be merciful and forgiving, and in that way be like our Lord. Number six, blessed are the clean of heart, for they shall see God. And this reminds us of the importance of purity, that wonderful virtue of chastity, purity, which is so despised, trampled underfoot nowadays in the world. The opposite is held up. And pity the poor children who are raised in this world where they are assaulted, indeed bombarded, with all the immorality from all the media, the music, the movies, video games, the television, everything that assaults them, all of it is impure. It's leading them away from God and away from this beautiful virtue of purity. But notice it says, blessed are the clean of heart, because our Lord tells us that we must not only be pure in action, but especially in thought. So this is cleanliness of heart. And not just the virtue of chastity itself, but indeed trying to get rid of all sin, that our heart will be pure, that it will be without sin, without stain, imitating our Blessed Mother, who is immaculate and pure of heart. Number seven, blessed are the peacemakers, for they should be called the children of God. So often there is enmity in this world. Someone is offended and harbors revenge, harbors a grudge, a dislike, even a hatred for another person. For us to be a means of healing those animosities, what a wonderful thing that is. But we have to begin with ourselves and ask ourselves, do I harbor any lack of forgiveness for another? So be a peacemaker, bringing people together to forgive one another. We say this in the act of charity. I forgive all whom I have injured, and I ask pardon. I ask pardon of all whom I have injured, and I forgive all who have injured me. And that is a wonderful thing for us to do, and to strive to be a peacemaker among men. And finally, blessed are they that suffer persecution for justice' sake, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. And we all suffer in different ways. We suffer misunderstandings, etc. And our Lord tells us, if they have treated me as they have done, the disciple is not greater than the master, you also, he told the apostles, will be cast out of the synagogues and persecuted. And they will think that they are honoring God by persecuting you. And we see this down through the ages, not just in the martyrs, but in all the saints. So let us honor the saints, but let us also aspire to become one of them. And we can do so by living God's commandments, but then striving to do more, to live the Beatitudes, which bring a blessedness, even in this life, and an everlasting reward in the life to come. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Ghost.